Splatoon 3 launches next year, and we might not get any news on it until then. Let's pretend to make our own. I still can't believe this is actually happening. Let's get the background info out of the way. Back in 2019, 3 months after owning a Switch, I noticed the Splatoon 2 special demo on the eShop and, interested, gave it a try. I loved it so much I bought the full game in a year of Switch Online and proceeded to obsess over it for the next 3.5 months. Afterwards, I began to get burnt out, and with content updates and Splatfests coming to a close, went back to other games like Smash Ultimate while still fondly valuing the good times I had with it. I never played Octo Expansion either. Fast forward about 2 years, and I'm sitting at my desk, watching a Nintendo Direct on the 17th of February 2021 at 10 PM Universal Time Coordinated, when at the end, bam, I'm a Splatoon fan again! This 3-minute long trailer and the resulting hype reignited my interest in this series. Suddenly, I felt the urge to nerd out about how much I love the game where squid kids and octopus kids shoot each other with vibrant tink to the sound of cephalopod gurgle rock. With that, I had hopes, dreams, wishes, and even some ideas. Not for words that would better replace dreams or wishes, but for the more important things in life. All of that combines to form. I presume the game would release in the summer of 2022, since the previous games and Octo Expansion released around summer. That happens to be when my GCSEs are supposed to be held, and if you live in the UK, you'll know those are pretty important. Definitely not something you want to be distracted from with a shiny new game release. Usually, the estimated end date for them is in the third week of June, so by that estimate, I'd like Splatoon 3 to launch on the 17th of June 2022 at the very earliest, assuming the government's A-level and GCSE plans stay intact. That said, give us a global test fire a few months before release so I can get distracted from my GCSEs for the shiny new game release. Maybe even two. Moving on to what they've released, I'd like a decent chunk of content at launch, so the base game doesn't feel unfinished like most other games Nintendo has made free content updates for. Obviously, this doesn't mean there shouldn't be many content updates. I like a lot of them, they created a large feeling of excitement and activity in the community, and they're what kept a lot of the playbase playing the last two games during their heydays. They should strive to strike a balance between making the game feel alive at launch and making it still feel alive for the next 2 or even 3 years. To successfully do that will require a lot of new ideas, which I only have a few of. Returning weapons are the easy ones to decide. Ideally, just about every main sub from the previous game should return, save the redundant ones. Specials are where it gets a bit trickier, due to rough balance histories making spamming some of these a viable or even meta strategy. Based on which ones I enjoy and can see being revamped if necessary, I'd like the Bomb Rush, Kraken, Splashdown, Inkstorm, and Booyah Bomb to return, while I would object to the return of the Bubbler, Echolocator, Incarmer, and especially the Stingray. I swear if they bring this back, the entire playbase will collectively go insane and not in a good way. For the actual new stuff, I do have some ideas for main weapons. Some are simple alterations, like a brush that can perform a spin attack instead of being pushed, or an area spray or splooshomatic that's viable outside of Turf War. Others are a bit more original. First off, an ink thrower. It's like a flamethrower, but it shoots ink. I'd translate this into Splatoon as a shooter with ridiculously fast firing speed, wide ink coverage, and a unique after ink ability that keeps damaging the opponent slightly after you've stopped firing at them, but very quick ink consumption and mediocre range and accuracy. It's basically that viable area spray or sploosh I mentioned earlier. Bonus points if they reference that one scene in Mad Max Fury Road by modelling it after an electric guitar. Another idea I had is a grenade launcher, which would fire weaker splat bombs, suction bombs, or burst bombs depending on the variant, at a smaller ink cost than the real ones. No main weapon remotely like it exists yet, so I think it would bring another unique, unorthodox playstyle to the game. Onto sub-weapons, I think the point sensor should be merged into the disruptor or toxic mist, as it's pointless when you can communicate with your team and still not worth sacrificing another sub for when you can't. One new idea I had for a sub is a remotely detonatable bomb. Press the button once to place it on the floor, and again to detonate it. Not much to say here. So I'll give you a more interesting idea, a placeable gusher. Pressing the button would lay it down where you are, and from there would act like the gushes seen elsewhere, creating a perhaps smaller column of ink that elevates you and blocks shots. I could imagine this being an interesting sub similar to the splash wall, if a bit problematic for balance due to it opening up all sorts of dev unintended shortcuts. Specials, again, are where it gets tricky to stay balanced. My first idea is a sentry that could be set up in a given spot and would fire ink at anyone within the proximity of it. It might need to have lower health or deal less damage than a player, but I could see it being well balanced since it would be less effective on offense and would require good positioning to use well. In fact, the crab robot we saw in the trailer might be essentially this. My only other idea is vague, a more balanced form of increased health or armor that won't take over the meta like the last two times. My rough idea was a gun that would require you to physically apply the armor to a teammate by shooting at them, which would admittedly face the issue of the user needing to babysit their teammates in a boring manner. Healing in general is tough to balance in competitive games, though you may have better ideas that you could comment down below while splatting that subscribe button. Putting these mains, subs and specials together, give every main weapon at least 3 sets by the end of content updates and try to build them around a clear purpose. I love the concept of mains being paired with different subs and specials that change their playstyle considerably, but some sets have zero synergy and make no sense to be together. It's disappointing when a set that you could like or could be really good has a bizarre sub or special that turns you or the competitive scene off. I'm not saying we should be able to customize our own loadouts, we all know how that would go down, just for the devs to put a little more thought into which weapons would go well together. And to complement all of these, make building gear less grindy. For how necessary some gear builds are at a high level, it sure can be a chore to build them. Ability chunks were a fantastic way of doing this, letting you explicitly give clothes specific sub-abilities, but the amount given to you is a bit too low for my liking, so I'd like them to go a bit further. Maybe give out more chunks through regular battles, perhaps universally lower the cost of scrubbing clothing like with the Splatfest tee, or even let you sell items you don't use for extra chunks or tickets. I'd also like if some less used abilities were removed, like Opening Gambit, Last Ditch Effort, Haunt, and Thermalink. Did you even remember those exist until I mentioned them? You might have. Do you actively use them?
I'm not good at rhetorical questions.
While they're at it, no more increased damage. It's taken over the meta twice already. I think we can do without it taking over a third time. But none of what I've talked about so far would matter without... I have even fewer new ideas for these. Like with weapons, keep most of the past stages, altering them if necessary to accommodate new weapons or movement options. If the change in setting from Inkopolis to Splatsville is a problem, come up with some excuse like Splatsville having replicas of old stages to
honour the legacy of Inkopolis.
However, leave out the more disliked stages from previous games, especially more 8 hours. Yeah, it's iconic and it's a stage in Smash Ultimate, but Urchin Underpass is similarly iconic and a battle stage in Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, yet that never returned in Splatoon 2. Besides, I don't care. My hatred for this stage transcends icon status. I don't think anyone can genuinely call it well designed or balanced, and I think we'd all be happy to see it be retired for once, wouldn't we?
There goes another bad rhetorical question.
Well, it's not healthy to be this negative all the time, so let's move on to my bigger wish for stages, for them to remain diverse and... fresh. I'm particularly referring to visuals here. As much as I prioritise gameplay in video games, I can easily imagine myself running around their locations freely and admire the details that bring them to life. For me, it's a massive part of world building, and it makes Splatoon's world believable, despite the times when cephalopod people held weekend-long sporting events to legally settle disputes over orange juice and toilet paper. While I don't dislike the new Badlands-inspired setting, it could get old very quickly if every new stage used it like it's been implied. Therefore, mix it up a bit with some more traditional urban environments, while experimenting with new stage concepts that would be fitting or interesting. I'd love to see what a mining quarry or a power plant could look like in the Splatlands. Give us anything that we can look at and say, wow, this is sick. And that's balanced and fun to play on. What I just said can also apply to gameplay elements. The shifty stations in Splatoon 2 had tons of gimmicks, some of which could work well in regular stages, but they were limited to Splatfests, thus can only be played now in Turf War private battles, while the regularly available stages feel a bit bland in comparison. I'd like more unique stage mechanics in Splatoon 3's new stages, and I'd even like shifty stations gone, but we'll get onto that later. Of course, you can't have stages without... Rated everyone 10 and up. I have
a feeling you get the gist by now. I don't have many solid ideas.
Let's just get it out of the way. Control points. It's a classic mode in shooters that should work well in Splatoon's fast-paced gameplay, having 3 or 5 points on the map that both teams have to take over. It might not be Splatoon-y enough, but the developers could easily solve this. My other wishes are smaller. There's the hotly requested Clan Blitz revamp to make it more manageable with a lack of communication. My idea was to have a super clam appear at the team's own basket if they collect 15 or 20 clams across all 4 teammates. On similar terms, I'd appreciate one of either Tower Control or Rainmaker being revamped, due to both having the same base concept of get important item to the enemy team's base. As for which one, I prefer Rainmaker's gameplay, but also believe it'd be much easier to rework Rainmaker into a different mode. It's difficult. I'll let you decide by commenting below while revamping your like videos playlist to include this one. Lastly, stages should be limited in which modes they can appear in, to let new stages be designed to fit specific modes better, and to prevent cursed map mode combinations like Camp Triggerfish Splat Zones or Kelp Dome Tower Control from appearing. I'd say have the missing map mode combinations be accessible through a place like Private Battles, but that'd be contradicting what I said earlier about shifty stations, which, hey, it's finally time to talk about! I was never a big fan of these. I like picking a team based on a theme debate, and dislike just about everything else. I think they could use a bunch of improvements. Mirror matches are an unfortunate consequence of no two teams having an equal amount of players, but are frustrating regardless because they appeared a lot in more heavily skewed Splatfests and didn't count towards overall results, in extreme cases making lots of Splatfests reverse popularity contests. I'd have them count a fraction of a normal battle, since having them count fully would only reverse the issue at hand rather than fix it. I do not understand synergy bonuses. If they're meant to incentivize team organization, then maybe they shouldn't apply to solo queue, where it's impossible to properly plan team compositions. Confining them to team mode makes perfect sense until you remember team mode was removed from Splatoon 2 in an update, which tells me players didn't like that mode. There's always the plan B of better team communication in a team game. The big one, ranked modes and Splatfests. Some people do not like Turf War, myself included. Thus, when Splatfests only allow us to play Turf War, we feel frustrated that we're essentially robbed of our enjoyment of the game for a weekend. We don't want to feel like that, so this is a bit of a no-brainer. Additionally, I'd like to mention sponsored Splatfests, because these things drive me insane. Humanity has been extinct for 12,000 years and overtaken by new species. Yet not only are the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles still relevant, but these new species are celebrating Super Mario Bros.'s 35th anniversary as if it's happening in their time when it already happened in 2020. As much as I want them gone because of this, they've already happened. There's not much worse they can do anymore, so they can stay, I guess. Great, now I'm running out of transitions! I want Splatoon 3's single player to be massive, both in story and gameplay. Octo Expansion was a great start and would serve the best basis for this.
Is what I would say if I played it prior to making this video. Going off other people's gameplay,
it had a plethora of unique, interesting, and challenging levels, tied together by a surprisingly dark plot and deep world building, all of which massively expanded the scope of this series. Already, that should give you an idea of how high my hopes are. Since I'm ironically more in it for the story than the gameplay this time, I'd like them to go very deep with a new story that both ties up loose ends from previous games and introduces some new elements. Do not be the third repeat of Get the Great Zapfish. This is a completely new game on the same console as the last one, so we're going to need a hook to get us interested, and the story happens to be a convenient one. From what we have so far, it's looking to focus on the Salmonids, having now formed a relationship with the Inklings and Octopus. battlings, and possibly explore who the Salmonids and Mr. Grizz really are. I'd like them to go even further, showing, for instance, what the Idols did after the final fest, what happened to Inkopolis to cause everyone to move to Splatsville, whether Team Order might still be around, whether there might be more human relics like Judd, or even if there's a possibility that humans might still exist in the Splatoon universe. As for where Daft Punk tie into this, they likely don't. Korokoro are probably paying tribute to them. As for gameplay, again, don't be another repeat of the previous game's hero modes. It could be like an ideal multiplayer game's campaign, with a large variety of decently challenging levels that double as good tutorials, and lots of weapons to use in them, possibly with updates to add more levels as new weapons are added to multiplayer. Alternatively, they could experiment with an open world where you explore a vast area in the Splatlands, finding new weapons, bosses, and story items as you explore, and maybe traversing multiplayer maps and suburbs of Splatsville when you find them. This one would massively help tie the game's world together in an awesome way, even if it would require a hefty budget. Whatever they end up doing, they should make something that's new, that's expansive, and that people will really want to play. This is kind of a miscellaneous category for larger features I'd like to see. Salmon Run would have to be recontextualized for aforementioned story reasons, and its gameplay might need an overhaul to reflect this. I'd still like it to resemble its original roots, since I love this mode and will sometimes play it more than the regular multiplayer modes. Private battles should be replaced with custom lobbies that have the option of being publicly searchable or password locked. This way, custom game modes like Hide and Seek or Squid and Octo Party can be easily searched for without the need for external resources like Discord, and can stay out of regular turf war lobbies. Offline CPU battles were somehow never a thing in Splatoon 2, despite online multiplayer on the Switch requiring a paid subscription. Safe to say I'd like them in Splatoon 3,
and I'd ideally like the concept of paid online to disappear from the games industry.
Split-screen multiplayer, if possible on the Switch's little baby hardware, should be implemented in as many multiplayer modes as possible, even the online ones. While this could lead to a rise in Little Timmy's Roman X rank, a system of some sort to prevent this could easily be implemented, just like a load of other easy online improvements that were never added to Splatoon 2. A replay theatre would help a lot. In any competitive game, replays are great for match analysis, video creation, and boasting to your identityless social media followers. Splatoon 2 uses the Switch's universal video capture function, which does its job fine, but having to work with 30-second long clips is a bit tricky. Letting us save the whole match would make this much easier. Just don't pull a Smash Ultimate and disable the capture button while only allowing videos of certain modes to be saved. Possibly an unpopular request, I'd like a new iteration of Splatnet. Splatnet 2 was very convenient for checking map mode rotation schedules or past match statistics without needing to whip the Switch out, and I'd like potential Splatnet 3 to expand on this. Let us view and create plaza posts or order food and drink on the app. In general, the Switch Online app had potential for good companion services that went both untapped and ruined by standing next to the only way to do voice chat on the Switch. Lastly, I don't think Splatoon needs one, but I'd be down for some new mode that doesn't relate to any existing ones. Notably, I'm talking about one that I feel obligated to mention due to its sheer fan demand, apartments. The fanbase goes wild for these. Every depiction of an apartment results in major outcries of "add apartments to Splatoon 3!" Meanwhile, I've never clearly seen the benefits of them. The only one I can think of is world building, which I did express interest in earlier. Regardless, if Splatoon wants to have a side of social simulator with its third-person shooter, I'd roll with it. Now for all those smaller improvements. Bring back the lobby minigames. I didn't play them in Splatoon 1 because I never had one of these, but the people want them back. I did play Squid Beats 2 and can declare that every game that prides itself on its soundtrack needs a rhythm minigame. Add more D-pad messages like "nice work," "play the objective," or "Nintendo, your game sucks massive doo-doo, I'm selling my Switch for a PS5. It's a team game and teams should be able to properly communicate among themselves. Region lock gear is dumb. Make it all available worldwide through the in-game shops or amiibo, not from pre-ordering a real-life t-shirt from Nintendo's website that they opened pre-orders for without telling anyone until after they went out of stock. Improve the netcode. Fighting games are more my forte when it comes to netcode implementation, but I do know that dedicated servers are way better than peer-to-peer connections for shooters. I also know the tick rate should be 60Hz instead of 30Hz or the 15Hz that Splatoon 2 somehow gets away with. While they're at it, improve X power distribution so losing isn't way more punishing than winning is rewarding,
is what I would say if I was in X rank.
Add cloud save functionality. I refuse to believe the devs never thought to simply save people's ranks to the servers so they could prevent people from save scumming to avoid rank loss. Every other multiplayer game does that, so Splatoon has no excuse not to. I have a feeling Nintendo might shut down Splatoon 2's online services and delist it from the eShop to get people to buy Splatoon 3. They haven't released a multiplayer game sequel on the same console since Mario Party 9, so they might not understand that this is an awful idea that would annoy so many people.
I like my media to be readily available. Don't do this. Please.
I have another, admittedly baseless, feeling Nintendo are developing ARMS 2 and are looking to release it in the same timeframe as Splatoon 3. In case it is in development, release ARMS 2 a good few months away from Splatoon 3 so it can have its deserved time in the spotlight. More importantly than anything I've said in this video, I want Splatoon 3 to be the best it can be. I know, this is a cliche way to end, but I truly believe Nintendo has struck a goldmine with this series and want them to make the best use of it. Splatoon is so unique, so stylish, and so memorable that it encouraged me, someone who's hardly played it in the last year, to make a video nerding out about my love for it and my hopes for the newest game. Any video game franchise that can do that is, in my eyes, special and deserves to be treated as such by its developers. Nintendo, don't disappoint us with this game. Now watch as none of my ideas get implemented because I'm not legally old enough to get hired at Nintendo and I doubt I would anyway just review concepts.